Palestine, the home of two of the world's great religions, the ancient crossroads of civilization, the land bridge spanning three continents, has a historical, political, and spiritual resonance that reverberates far beyond its narrow borders. There are few places on Earth where geography is so central to understanding the current conflict. To grasp the complexities of the struggle between Palestinians and Jews in the region, we need to know the maps. Yet, there is a lack of knowledge and information about the shape and contour of the contested area. The mainstream media simply do not provide maps, and when they do, they leave out critical information. The media often say the clash between Palestinians and Jews is as old as the hills. This is a fabrication. The actual conflict is about a century old and really develops with clarity after World War I. For more than 1,000 years, Jews traditionally have lived in relative harmony with their Arab neighbors. It was in Europe where, after centuries of pogroms and persecution, the greatest collective outburst of violence in history, the Holocaust, took place. Let's take a look at the maps and the geographical basis of the conflict. Palestine, Israel, and Imperial Geography. I'm David Barsamyan. Welcome to this special Free Speech TV report. Palestine is located in what is called the Middle East. The Middle East itself is an imperial construction. Prior to American hegemony in the region, the British called it the Near East or the Orient. It was always in relation to the superpower, the great imperial hegemon, that the geographical area was defined. Palestine becomes a province of the Imperial Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire, in 1516, and it develops internally within the Ottoman-Turkish framework. In the early 1880s, the first European Jews began to settle in Palestine. About a decade later, in 1894, a French Jewish captain, Alfred Dreyfus, was accused of selling secrets to the Germans. The Dreyfus affair erupted into an enormous vitriolic attack on Jews in France. This deeply disturbed Theodore Herzl, who was a Viennese journalist covering the trial. A year later, he wrote a book called The Jewish State. In 1897, the first Zionist Congress met in Basel, Switzerland. And this was the first time that the idea of a Jewish homeland was articulated. Herzl and other Zionist leaders designated different parts of the world as possible homelands for the Jewish people. Among the areas considered were Argentina, East Africa, and Palestine. In 1914, World War I breaks out. The Turks align themselves with the Germans against the British and the French. The Turks experience a series of defeats in the Middle East and elsewhere. The British seize Palestine. In their imperial designs on the region, and in particular Palestine, the British were making promises all over the place. For one, they entered an agreement with the French called the Sykes-Picot Agreement, in which they divided the Middle East. The French would get Lebanon and Syria, and the British essentially would get everything else. The Arabs were promised independence for their support in an uprising against the Turks. You may recall Lawrence of Arabia being a major figure in this particular episode. However, after World War I, the Arabs bitterly learned the truth of what was going on behind their backs. On November 2, 1917, the British Foreign Minister, Lord Arthur Balfour, wrote a letter to a British banker, Lord Rothschild, in which he said, "His Majesty's government looks with favor upon the creation of a homeland in Palestine for the Jews." Often the Balfour Declaration is interpreted as some kind of official act of the British Parliament. It was nothing of the sort. It should be emphasized that it was a private letter to a private British citizen. Nevertheless, the Balfour Declaration historically has been seen by Zionists as the juridical basis for the State of Israel. In fact, in the May 14, 1948 Declaration of Independence, the Israelis specifically refer to the Balfour Declaration as a kind of Magna Carta, as an enabling document which gave it legitimacy in its claim on Palestine. At the end of World War I, the British looked with favor upon immigration from Europe by European Jews to Palestine. The Suez Canal was the key waterway linking the crown jewel of the empire, India, to Britain. Jewish immigration into Palestine was seen as a critical element in the protection of the Suez Canal. The Jews in Palestine were a bulwark against independent Arab nationalism, which was always seen as a threat. And here it's important to point out that from the very beginning of Zionist immigration to Palestine, the Palestinians resisted what was going on. Right after World War I, until the beginning of World War II, there was a tremendous expansion of Jewish immigration from Europe to Palestine. Within a period of two decades, the Jewish population of Palestine tripled. In 1936, an extremely important event happens in Palestine. The Palestinians revolt. For 3 years, they fight the British. In this period, thousands of Palestinians were killed, many were exiled, and the Palestinian resistance was basically crushed by overwhelming British might. In 1937, the British set up the Peel Commission. Now, this was the first attempt to divide Palestine into Arab and Jewish areas. The Peel Commission plan allocated less than 30% of the overall area of Palestine to the Jews. This paralleled their population at that time. The Arabs got around 70-75% of the area of Palestine. Both the Arabs and the Jews rejected the Peel Commission plan. At the end of World War II, Britain and France are devastated. While they still preside over vast colonial empires, it's increasingly difficult and expensive for France and Britain to defend their overseas colonies. It is at this moment that the United States emerges as the superpower to replace Britain and France, particularly in the Middle East. The United States identified the oil reserves in the Middle East as one of the greatest prizes in the history of the world, and they meant to get it. And to get it, that meant easing out the British and the French from the region. During World War II, the British stopped all Jewish immigration to Palestine. After the war, with the devastation of the Holocaust on everyone's mind, hundreds of thousands of European Jews were sitting in refugee camps all over Europe. The United States, Britain, Canada, and other liberal democracies did not open their immigration quotas to these displaced European Jews. There was one place for them to go, and that was Palestine. The Jewish Agency, the political arm of the Zionist movement, made a proposal in August 1946. It literally turns the Peel Commission's plan on its head. In this plan, the Jewish Agency says that 2/3 of Palestine should go to the Jews and 1/3 to the Arabs. Jerusalem is regarded as a trusteeship under United Nations control. In May 1947, the British officially announce to the United Nations that it is ending its mandate over Palestine. The UN responds. On November 29, 1947, it issues its own partition plan for Palestine into two separate states, a Jewish state and an Arab state. Now you can note that this division of Palestine by the UN is in rather sharp contrast in terms of demographics. Under the UN plan, the Jews are given 55% of the land of Palestine, even though their population is only 35%. The Arab majority, with 55% of the population, is only offered 45% of the land. The Palestinians reject the UN proposal. Why? The Palestinians felt that the UN proposal inherently discriminated against their majoritarian rights in Palestine, and they refused to accept the UN proposal. Almost immediately after the UN proposal, which was promulgated on November 29, 1947, civil war breaks out between the Palestinians and the Jews. Much of the fighting takes place in the Palestinian-allocated areas of Palestine. On May 14, 1948, the Jews of Palestine declare a sovereign independent state. It is about this time that Arab armies from surrounding countries enter the fray. They were no match for the some 65,000 well-trained Israeli Jews who fought them off. At the end of the fighting in 1949, when the UN arranged an armistice in Palestine, the Jews now controlled 78% of the land of Palestine. This was significantly beyond the UN partition plan of 1947. The Palestinians were left with the West Bank and Gaza. The West Bank was occupied by the Jordanians. Gaza was occupied by the Egyptians. The struggle for Palestine today is over this remaining 22% of the original land. This constitutes Israel's recognized international border, the so-called Green Line. A critical outcome of the 1948 and 1949 fighting was the creation of the Palestinian refugee problem. 700,000 to 800,000 Palestinians were either driven from their homes or fled the Israelis. They wound up in refugee camps in Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, and Egypt. In the 1948 and 1949 war, the Zionists, who were better trained and organized and better equipped than their Palestinian and Arab adversaries, sought to maximize their control over all the land of Palestine. And the Israeli effectively nullified all the previous maps dealing with the region. Historically, maps have been designed by imperial cartographers sitting in London or Paris, thousands of miles removed from the actual area of contest. In the case of Palestine, the mapmakers played a crucial role. But with the evolution of time, and particularly the Israeli military conquests in 1948-49 and again in 67, the imperial maps dissolved. Thank you. geographical status quo, that is, with Jordan controlling the West Bank and Egypt controlling the Gaza Strip, remains in place until the June 1967 war, when Israel captures the West Bank and Gaza. It is now in control of the entire land of Palestine. Yeretz Israel, the land of Israel, is now realized by the Zionists. Israel was determined from the very beginning, shortly after the 1967 war, to move settlers into colonies in these areas. Israel was determined to alter the demographic realities of these newly captured areas and to incorporate them into Israel proper. The West Bank, traditionally, according to Zionists, is called Judea and Samaria. It is considered part of Yeretz Israel, and the colonization of this area proceeds apace shortly after the 67 war. Literally, hundreds of thousands of Israelis are moved into subsidized housing on the West Bank, taking the best land, using the aquifer, and essentially denying Palestinians the possibility for sovereignty in a viable independent state. There's also been extensive colonization in the Gaza Strip. About 30% of the Gaza Strip is controlled by Israeli settlers. About 40 to 50% of the West Bank is occupied by Israeli colonizers. What the Israelis have done in the remaining 22% of Palestine is essentially radicalize the whole nature of the geography and maps, rendering them essentially irrelevant. With this massive colonization campaign in which hundreds of thousands of Israeli settlers are now living in the West Bank and in occupied East Jerusalem and on the Gaza Strip, that has completely changed the demographics of the area. And let me give you an idea of what these settlements look like. If you could just close your eyes for a moment and imagine you're in a San Diego subdivision where there are swimming pools and green lawns and well-designed, carefully crafted homes. And across the street, you have Tijuana. You have open sewers, you have dirt roads, you have substandard housing, you have very unsanitary and overcrowded housing conditions. That is something that Palestinians face not only in Gaza, but in the West Bank and in East Jerusalem as well. This colonization scheme, which was rather sophisticated, was organized by the Israeli government, and it was encouraged by the enormous amount of subsidies given to the colonizers. In other words, if you were born in Brooklyn or in Minsk, and using the law of return when you landed in Israel, you immediately became an Israeli citizen, you couldn't easily afford an apartment in Tel Aviv, but you could afford housing in the newly conquered territories of Judea and Samaria, that is the West Bank, and Gaza, because the government was heavily subsidizing housing in this area, making it very convenient and easy for people to move in. The 1987 Intifada was in response to enormous pressures on ordinary Palestinians, their loss of work and income, the destruction of their olive groves, the destruction of fruit trees and bulldozing of homes, and military checkpoints and curfews and collective punishment. All of these things finally culminated in the Intifada of 1987, a Palestinian revolt throughout the West Bank and Gaza against Israeli military rule. It's important to note that there are now about 10 million people living in historical Palestine, about 6 million Jews, 1 million Israeli Arabs living inside the borders of pre-1967 Israel, and then another 3 million or so on the West Bank and Gaza. The Intifada lasted from approximately 1987 to 1991. Many people were killed, thousands more were injured, many houses were destroyed, and the Palestinian political weakness at the end of the Intifada directly led to the Madrid Conference and then the Oslo peace process. The details of the Oslo settlement have long been obscured from most people, particularly in the United States. Maps have not been published about what the accords were designed to do, nor was there any explication about the enormous disparity in power in terms of the two parties that were represented at Oslo. On one side, you have Israel, backed by the remaining superpower, the United States, and on the other side, you have the PLO, represented by Yasser Arafat, who is enormously weakened position, has very little leverage, cannot exact any of the demands for justice that the majority of the Palestinian people are asking for. He acquiesces essentially to his own surrender. Palestinians under Israeli military occupation in the West Bank and Gaza live daily lives of humiliation. They are surrounded, they are stopped, they are searched. They're asked for identification papers. They're not allowed to proceed. It's extremely difficult for Palestinians to conduct any normal type of existence. This leads to enormous tensions and desperation, and part of the rage and anger toward the Israeli occupiers can be best understood if there is an appreciation of the dire circumstances of daily Palestinian life. They're essentially living in prison camps. After Israel's dramatic military victory in the 1967 war with its conquest of the West Bank, Gaza, and the Golan Heights, it emerges as a United States asset in the Middle East. It becomes a strategic tool for U.S. imperial power. Now the hegemon is sitting in Washington, D.C., but he has a mechanism in place in the Middle East to exercise control on this strategically extremely valuable area. Most Americans simply have no idea as to what is going on in the West Bank and Gaza. The number of settlers, colonizers, in those two occupied territories has literally doubled since Oslo. And this buildup of Israeli colonization throughout the 1990s, after Oslo in 93, right through the end of the period, culminates in the Second Intifada. Now, let me give you some little background as to what precipitated the actual outbreak of Palestinian resistance at the end of September in the year 2000. In the month prior, there was the Camp David summit, which brought Clinton and Arafat and Ehud Barak to Camp David in Maryland to negotiate a settlement. What the Palestinians were offered was a take-it-or-leave-it diktat with no contiguous Palestinian land, separated by bypass roads, which were only available for use by Jewish settlers. There was Jewish control, Israeli control of the valuable aquifer, and more encroachment of Palestinian land. This is what the Palestinians were asked to accept at Camp David. Arafat refused, and then on September 28th, Ariel Sharon, who was then not part of the Israeli government, but a notorious figure in terms of the Palestinian imagination, someone who is known as the butcher of Sabra and Shatila, someone who has committed numerous war crimes against Palestinian civilians, goes to the Haram al-Sharif, the third most sacred site in Islam in Jerusalem. He's accompanied by 1,000 Israeli security forces. This was considered to be an act of supreme provocation. And indeed, the Palestinians were provoked. And now you begin the Al-Aqsa Intifada from late September 2000, which has resulted in the deaths of well over 1,000 Palestinians, hundreds of Israelis, the phenomenon of suicide bombings, and an ongoing struggle for the 22% of Palestine that is still under Israeli control. One of the reasons that the Palestinian Revolution, the Al-Aqsa Intifada, is viewed with great trepidation by Washington is because if it is successful, it may spark other revolts in neighboring Arab lands. Israel is considered a bridgehead in the Arab Middle East. It's like a land-based aircraft carrier. It's actually been called that. Everything that the United States has done in the Middle East and through, actually, its local cop on the beat, Israel, has been to control any kind of independent Arab nationalism. And what do we mean by independent Arab nationalism? Well, quite clearly, Arabs cannot have the funny idea that the oil that is in their land belongs to them and not to the United States. You've been watching a special report, Palestine, Israel, and Imperial Geography. I'm David Barsamian for Free Speech TV. Stay tuned to Free Speech TV for more coverage of this important issue, the struggle for Palestine.